sa kanya. Good morning, Presidential Communications Secretary Martin Andanar.
Hello, Rocky.
Good morning. Mabuti, sir.
Audio. Wala dong audio. Ayun. Good morning, members of MPC at sa lahat ng nanonood sa atin sa PTV4 at nakikinig po sa atin sa Radyo ng Bayan. As you all know, yesterday was the 6th cabinet meeting at the palace at marami hong napag-usapan doon sa palasyo tulad po ng mga priority bills ng ating Pangulo sa Kongreso. At tayo po ay mapalad at kasama natin ngayon yung bagong secretary ng Presidential Legislative Liaison Office. Pero bago pong lahat, nais ko lamang magsalita tungkol sa communication policy ng ating opisina ng Presidential Communications Office. Bagaman marami po tayong natanggap na batikos at mga constructive criticism mula sa ating mga kolumnista, mga senador, at nais ko lamang po ipabatid sa lahat na tinatanggap po natin ang mga kritisismo bilang constructive criticisms, and we also welcome the wisdom of Senator Panfilo Lacson for bringing up the issue on the problem of having too many spokespersons. So I brought up the issue to the President yesterday in the meeting, and I told the President that, Mr. President, we have been heavily criticized for the past week, and this person has been the flavor of the week. Sabi ko, Mr. President, as far as I know, we only have one presidential spokesperson, and the presidential spokesperson is none other than Ernesto Abella. And this secretary only comes in once a secretary, when every time Secretary Abella is not around, that is the only time that this secretary comes in to explain and to talk on behalf of the president. And so I appealed to the cabinet secretaries to follow the standard operating procedure, which was agreed upon right from day one, July 1 of 2016. That it is only indeed Secretary Abella who can speak on behalf of the President. Now, for clarificatory questions regarding pronouncements of our President Duterte, I asked the President to order that all questions that are asked about clarificatory pronouncements should be directed first to the Presidential Communications Office, and it is only then that the Presidential Communications Office shall decide who among the secretaries or members of the cabinet can comprehensively explain a presidential pronouncement that needs clarification. So therefore, pumayag po ang Pangulo na ganun po dapat ang sistema natin, and it was also reiterated for the record, members of the press, that the Executive Secretary Bingbong Medialdea and the Special Assistant to the President Bongo, as we have been in discussion, we've been talking about this for the past 3 weeks, at yun din po yung utos nila. Pero it was last night that I brought up the issue. And for now, for the information of everyone, if you have any questions, clarificatory questions of what the President said yesterday or last night, please go to us, the Presidential Communications Office, and we will be the ones to direct you to a cabinet member who can comprehensively explain kung ano po ang sinabi ng ating Pangulo, kung malabo po para sa ating lahat. This is to avoid confusion. So yun po. So now let's proceed to the proper...
May question lang. Okay. Ina, yeah. Question about the statement. Microphone, please. Thank you.
Hi, sir. Sir, dun sa sinasabi mo that for clarificatory queries, we go to you first and not the presidential spokesperson? Ganun
no,
ba yun?
The PCO.
PCO?
Yeah, PCO.
Which covers
Because
Mr.
The office of the presidential spokesperson is under there. The presidential communications office. Yeah.
Okay, it's ibig sabihin, it's hindi po that we need to give you a heads up on possible clarificatory questions that we may be asking in regular press conferences attended by Mr. Abella.
I would suggest that because what usually happens is that the president says something and then you clarify things. So we all know that we have a Viber group here for the heads up. So what you can do is to avoid and not to duplicate the questions is just ask the Viber group, ask me personally, and then Ernie Abella and myself, we are a team, no? And then we will huddle together and we will compose, we will craft the message of or the clarification that you need, no? And if in the meeting we need more intelligence and more wisdom, then we go to the cabinet secretary, who is the expert on that particular field that we want to clarify. But please do not be confused that the presidential communications office is also the office of spokesperson Abella.
Ibig sabihin, sir, are you expecting us to give you a heads up on clarificatory questions that we may raise in a regular press conferences by Mr. Abella?
That usually happens anyway. If you have, diba, usually kung meron kayong gustong linawin, it happens, you know. But we can institutionalize it now. Na kung meron pong tanong, para hindi rin po magulo, para hindi po magka-doble-doble yung mga tanong natin lahat, because usually I get 20, 30 messages, the same message. I don't mind you messaging me. But also, kung sino po yung ating head ng ano, ng ating MPC, no, ng bagong opisyal, meron po tayong heads up na Viber group wherein we can coordinate better.
Yes. I think, sorry, pati pag yung sa speech ni Presidente, minsan kailangan namin ng ma-clarify yung some statement of the President during his speech isang event.
So para mas mabilis po yung ating correspondence.
Most of the time, sir, ganun yung hinihingi ng MPC.
Sige po. Okay.
Benji Liwanag and Dexter Ganibe.
Good morning, Secretary. Number one, we're only talking about clarificatory.
Yes,
on dun. What, kasi may mga programs din kami, meron din kami that we can talk also with the secretaries directly. Mm-hmm. Pero hindi namin pag-usapan definitely, or minsan papasok din naman kung kailangan. Sabi nyo nga, pero kailangan pa ba namin, do we need to talk to you first before getting a secretary for an interview like in a radio station or something?
Well, it's a good question, Benji. No? Ayoko naman na ordering kayo na ganun gawin because we are a democracy, we have freedom of speech. No? Yung sa akin lang po is when I talk to the cabinet officials, ang sabi ko lang na to direct the question to us first. No? So that we will not fall into a very confusing situation. No? Kung meron po kayong, kasi may mga programa po ilan dito sa radio program, may sarili-sarili kayong programa. Now, you call the secretary, pag sinabi niyang okay, di okay, walang problema. Yung pakiusap ko lang po doon sa kabinete ay at inaprubahan na muna ng presidente, kung meron mga clarificatory questions yung media, halimbawa may sinabi ang Pangulo the day before at meron tanong ang media na ano po ba talaga ibig sabihin nun, ay i-refer po sa PCO para yung PCO na ho ang magde-desisyon kung paano. Para hindi ho na iba yung sinabi ni Secretary X, iba yung sinabi ni Secretary Y. So lahat ay within the ambit of the Presidential Communications Office because we are also trying to do a very good job here. No? We're trying to manage the situation. So if I don't put my foot down, then it's a damn if you do, damn if you don't thing. So yun lang po.
Thank you very much, Secretary.
Para nabibigyan lahat pati MPC members, sir.
Oh yeah, of course, alam naman natin na the Malacañang press corps is the priority, you being here in Malacañang.
Dexter Ganibe? microphone. Ina, please the mic. Microphone.
Secretary, good morning.
Morning, Lex.
Hindi po ba mayroon na tayong team o kung meron nga ba tayong team sa PCO na siyang nagmo-monitor na sa bawat live speech ng Pangulo para bago pa man magdatingan yung mga tanong ay meron na kayong idea kung ano yung binanggit ng Pangulo o kung wala mang dumarating na tanong ay mabigyan ka agad ito ng paglilinaw mula sa communications group kung anong ibig niyang sabihin doon sa kanyang kababanggit pa lang. Kasi kung hihintayin natin yung proseso na may magtatanong pa, na pag-usapan na siya ng marami sa iba't ibang media at nagbigay na ng iba't ibang interpretasyon bago pa makapagbigay ng paliwanag ang palasyo.
It's a good question. You have a point there, Dex, no? Ngayon, we do have a team. And we do clarify amongst ourselves kung ano talagang ibig sabihin ng sinabi ng presidente. But then again, we do not want to speculate if the media got it or did not get it. You have your own ways of writing your stories, and you are all objective and you want an accurate report, no? So alam ko naman na kahit na alam niyo na kung ano ibig sabihin minsan, kung alam nyo nang klarong-klaro na, but you still vet on that information kung tama ba yung pagkakaintindi ninyo. So, hahayaan ko po kayo na because it is your right, we have press freedom, hindi ko pangihimasukan ang inyong pag-iisip. But I am just telling you that kung meron po kayong mga tanong, if you want to clarify some issues or some statements, that the go-to department is the PCO. Wala nang iba.
Secretary, may question pa about ano, kasi may, can
yeah,
you,
sure.
Other topic, sir?
Sure.
Benji Liwanag?
Napaki oras, sir, no? It's okay, you can, mga 5 minutes, 5 minutes lang.
Sir, klaruin ko lang, right now, merong Senate hearing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. May tumitistigo ngayon, Lambada Boys member, nakasama daw sa death squad na inutusan daw ni Pangulong Duterte na pumatay ng mga kriminal at mag-massacre ng mga Muslim. Ang bigat kasi nung paratang versus Pangulong Duterte. Nung may pinasabog daw na cathedral sa Davao, iniutos daw po ni Mayor Duterte at that time. Ano pong reaction ninyo rito, Secretary?
Yung ba ay sinabi na?
Ngayon po,
kasalukuyang
ongoing
po
yung
investigation ni Senator De Lima?
Yes, Secretary.
Antayin ho natin muna yung kabuuan, yung buod ng sasabihin ng testigo po ng Senadora bago po tayo magre-react. At pagdating po dyan, I will also consult the DOJ Secretary Aguirre. Diyan po. Hindi po tayo sasagot ng basta-basta. Sasagot po tayo ng isang komprehensibong sagot para tapusin natin yung hearing para at least isang sagot lang.
Maraming salamat po muli.
Laila and then Ace.
Good morning. Sir, speaking of contradictory statements, Secretary Lorenzana said there was little basis for the President's pronouncement that U.S. soldiers in Mindanao are under threat. So, how is the palace taking this? And will the president reassess his position that U.S. soldiers have to go since his own defense secretary is saying there's no threat to them?
Hindi ko nabasa yung statement ni Secretary Del, pero naulanigan ko na in one of our conversations that the Secretary of National Defense is referring to the camp. If you stay within the camp, then you are safe. Diba? Nasa loob ka ng kampo eh. But if you go outside the camp, then we cannot assure your safety. Kasi nasa labas ka ng kampo eh. I think that's the meaning of that statement.
But he also said, sir, there are also combatants, not just ordinary citizens. So,
who's the combatant?
The U.S. soldiers.
Oh yes, kahit naman eh, kung sa, hindi naman bulletproof ang isang tao eh. Kahit kombatant ka, pag tinamaan ka ng bala, hindi naman bulletproof ang ulo natin eh. Siyempre, kung matatamaan ka ng bala, magiging responsibilidad pa yan ng ating gobyerno. Kasi siyempre, nasa Philippine territory. Ang ibig sabihin lang po ng ating Pangulo, dahil nga naalala ho ng ating mga kapatid na Muslim yung mga nangyari during the turn of the century. Siyempre, kukulo po yung dugo ng ilan sa mga kapatid natin. At yung mga terorista, hindi naman ho natin alam kung sino-sino sila. Wala naman silang mga mukha. So, ang sinasabi lang po ng Pangulo ay yung kaakibat na panganib at sa kanilang seguridad, they should consider that.
Sir, last na lang. You do not see this as a contradiction or a repudiation of what the President said
Defense Secretary? No, hindi naman contradiction yun. Kasi ang pagkarinig ko dun sa usapan namin, no, narinig ko na it's really, if you're inside the camp, then you are safe. Parang tayong lahat, pumunta tayo ng Hulo. Eh, meron ba lumalabas sa kampo dito? Pumuntang Hulo? Walang lumalabas eh. Because, pag lumabas ka, siguradong malaki ang tsansa na pwede kang kidnapin ng Abu Sayyaf. Dahil lalo na media, di ba? Alam naman natin kung anong nangyari dun sa mga kasama natin noon. No? Na-kidnap sa basilan yan, di ba?
Oh. Sa
Sulu rin. Ano? Sulu. So, yun, merong danger, kumbaga. It's like an advisory lang na ingat tayo.
Ace Romero?
Follow up dun sa Senate hearing. Although sabi nyo, hindi muna magbibigay ng basta-basta ng statement. Pero do you think the President is capable of giving such directive?
I don't think he's capable of giving a directive like that.
Why say? For the record, why?
Why? Eh, di ba, inimbestigahan na nga noon yan, nung Commission on Human Rights, nung sinaunang panahon, nung mayor pa o si Pangulo, at wala namang charge. Wala naman silang nakitang direktang ebidensya.
Thank you, sir.
Pero antayin muna natin yung magiging kabuuan ng investigasyon sa Senado, Mr. Romero.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. May other issue? Or JP Soriano and then Ina, may question?
Go, no?
JP?
May lakad po si Secretary. Pero meron pa, don't worry, kasi pagkatapos Secretary, okay ka lang? O sige, okay. No.
Good morning, sir. I'm JP Soriano from JMA. Sir, tanong ko lang po yung, can you share to us kung ano po yung mga napag-usapan ni former President Fidel Ramos sa cabinet meeting kahapon? I know it's about China. He acted as the special envoy and may mga kasama po at ang ibang experts doon. Can you just briefly share to us what was discussed? And are we leaning towards a real bilateral talk na with the Chinese government?
Sorry, JP, wala ako doon sa usapan eh, yung sa mga envoy. Wala ako doon sa usapan nung nagkaroon po ng meeting. Kasi doon during the cabinet, iba po yung napag-usapan namin sa gabinete. And after the cabinet, meron pang isang meeting ang Pangulo na hindi po kasama ngayon lingkod. So hindi po ako makakomento doon. Sorry.
Yeah. How about the cabinet meeting po?
Hindi, mamaya magbibigay si spokesperson Abelia ng rundown ng ano nangyari doon sa cabinet meeting kapon. Pero ang mahalaga siguro ay, di ba, matagal na hong hindi na-convene ng LEDAC at alam kong mahalaga din para sa inyo na malaman kung ano yung mga priority bills ng ating Pangulo at mapalad tayo na nandito ngayon ng ating bagong kalihim ng Presidential Legislative Liaison Office. So, kung wala na ho tayong tanong...
Salamat po.
Okay. Ina. Last po, Ina. Sige.
Sir, a few days ago, si Yusek Abella talked about coming up with an independent foreign policy that's less dependent on the U.S. Does this mean that we're looking at building a stronger alliance with China? Are we diverting to China?
No, hindi naman. When you create an independent foreign policy, it's really just saying that we are a sovereign state. We are not beholden to any country. And once and for all, we can say to ourselves that we are standing up on our own two feet, you know. Yun lang yun. Hindi naman na we are not severing ties with our allies. And merong mga, yung visiting force agreement, yung mutual defense treaty, you know, ano yan eh. Our friendship with the Americans go a long, long way, and it cannot, you know, hindi naman ganun na we marami tayong allies, kasama na yung ASEAN na sinabi na nga ng Pangulo sa kanyang speech during the inauguration, the President will respect.
Mm-hmm. But in having a less dependent, being less dependent on the U.S., what do you mean by that specifically? For instance, in the region, the Philippines is one of the biggest recipients of military aid from the U.S. Mm-hmm. How do you see that affecting, or are you seeing a decrease in the military assets that we're getting from the U.S.? And if so, how do you intend to fill in the gap for those?
That question will be answered better by the Secretary of the National Defense. No? But as far as I'm concerned and as far as I know, tuloy-tuloy po ang ating paikipag-ugnayan sa ating mga allies. Walang ano yun.
Last. The President has ordered Secretary Lorenzana and a team of experts to head to Russia and China to check out what possible military assets we can get from them. These are countries which we hardly get military assets from in the past. Isn't that also contrary to the statement of President Duterte a while back in the V. Luna General Hospital, where he actually took a swipe at the quality of equipment that China offers? I mean, now we're considering that when he said na medyo hindi kagandahan yung quality doon.
Alam mo, pag libre siya or mababa ang presyo o mababa yung interest, no, there's nothing wrong with it. No? Hindi naman lahat ng produkto ng China, no, ay masama. No? In fact, siguro most of your laptops here are being produced in China. You know? Most of the things that we use here, maybe this microphone is also made in China. Pero meron ding mga produkto na hindi maganda. Diba? So, sa akin naman, depende yan sa produkto. Siguro yung nabanggit po ng ating Pangulo na mga produkto galing China, yun po yung mga produkto na sumablay.
Okay, thank you, Secretary.
Okay, so let's start. We are fortunate to be joined by the new head of the Presidential Legislative Liaison Office, or PLLO, Secretary Adelino Baguio Sitoy. Secretary Sitoy is no longer, is not a stranger to government work. And prior to his present appointment, this former dean and cum laude graduated from the College of Law, is a graduate of the College of Law of the University of Cebu, and served as assistant fiscal of the city of Cebu at the age of 27, the youngest at that time, acting fiscal of Toledo City, and the youngest at that time also, commissioner of the Cebu Ports Authority, and director of the Metropolitan Cebu Water District. His foray into politics began when he became an elected member of the Sangguniang Bayan of Cordova, Cebu, and later an assemblyman for Cebu Province. Secretary Sitoy won as Vice Mayor of Cordova and elected as Mayor of Cordova 3 times. He spearheaded the Cebu Movement for Federalism, an advocacy that is timely and propitious in his present position at the PLLO. To hear more about this and other priority legislation of the Duterte administration, ladies and gentlemen, members of the Malacañang Press Corps, let us all give a warm welcome to Secretary Adelino Baguio Sitoy. Sir, it's all yours.
Thank you, Secretary. Good morning, brothers and sisters in the media. Actually, you are no longer my brothers and sisters, you are my grandchildren. I would like to be asked in English because I have neglected our national language. I am the main advocate of the Cebuano Visayan language. I'm the president of the Visayan Academy of Arts and Letters. And I have co-authored a dictionary, 66,000 English words translated into Cebuano Visayan. And I'm running a column in Bisdak, Sunstar, weekly column about history, in Cebuano again. Although I have written in English the history of our town, and I have co-authored the history of the city of Cebu. This is a new assignment of mine. I resigned my position as vice mayor on August 31, 2016. I was elected as such last May after having served as mayor for 9 years. And before my election as mayor, I was dean of the College of Law of the University of Cebu. I put up the college, and luckily in our first batch and second batch landed in the top 10 in the bar exams. And before that, I was in the Batasan during the time of President Marcos, regular Batasan Pambansa. Yesterday, I called the attention of the president about the membership of the LEADAC. The LEADAC before was convened only 2 times during the presidency of President Aquino. And so this time, we intend to meet regularly. And in the composition, the chairman, of course, is the president. The vice chairman is the vice president. And the members are the president of the Senate and the speaker of the House, plus 7 members of the cabinet. And additionally, there are 3 members of the Senate, aside from the Senate president. And they have been nominated already. They are Senator Franklin Drilon, Senator Vicente Soto III, Senator Ralph Recto, and the 3 members of the House, aside from the Speaker, are Congressman Rodolfo Pariñas, Congressman Danilo Suarez, Congressman Dakila Carlo Coa, and the representative of the local government units was already mentioned yesterday, although the name has not been given to us yet. And another representative from the youth sector. There were names that were mentioned, but actually I have not received the official one, the name of the official one. And there is a representative from the private sector. There will also names nominated, but I have yet to receive officially the final nominee. These are the LEADAC members. And all in all, 20 members all in all. Yesterday, we made mention also of some priority bills. Given priority were these bills that were the subject of a memorandum from the Executive Secretary addressed to us for the formulation of the appropriate work plans relative to these bills mentioned in the SONA of the President. One, the strengthening of counterterrorism programs, which covers amendments to the Human Security Act, also known as the Anti-Terrorism Law, the Anti-Money Laundering Act, and the Anti-Cybercrime Act. And then the next subject of the memorandum was the passage of the Whistleblowers Act, followed by the strengthening of witness protection program, and then the creation of the Department for Overseas Filipinos. and the passage of the Bangsamoro Basic Law. The Bangsamoro Bill did not become a law because it got stuck up in the Senate, and so it has to be refiled again, starting from all over again. The Department of the DBM has also proposed priority measures like the right sizing of the bureaucracy and contemplated the creation of the Department of Housing and Urban Development and the Budget Reform Bill. The Department of Finance has also recommended priorities in the tax reform package comprising of the reduced personal and corporate income tax and the tax on fuel, the tax on sugary products, and the adjustments in sin taxes. And from the INDI is the proposal to amend the Community Act number 1, the National Defense Act, in order to revive the ROTC. These are the recommended priorities from these departments. In short, the possible sources of priority measures will be the 10-point socioeconomic agenda mentioned by the President in Davao, the SONA legislative commitments, the Philippine Development Plan, the enabling measures integral to strategic goals of previous national development plans, and the other presidential pronouncements. Referring to the SONA, there were 15 legislative commitments mentioned by the President in his SONA on July 25, 2016. And we have divided these 15 and classified them into 4 categories. The security, justice, and peace category, the economic development category, the good governance category, and the human development and poverty alleviation category. These are the 4 classifications of the 15 legislative commitments mentioned by the President in his SONA. Those are all.
A question, Ace Romero from Philippine Star.
Secretary, just wondering why some measures like the death penalty and federalism were not mentioned in the priority bills.
First, the with respect to federalism, that is included in the commitments included in the SONA are already also prioritized, although in terms of in the order of priority, what were mentioned by the executive secretary were given attention first. But under the SONA, good governance, federalism is included. And included also are media, freedom of information, Whistleblowers Act, and the Witness Protection Program Enhancement.
The death penalty, Secretary.
death penalty is included in under security, justice, and peace, with reference to anti-terrorism.
Any more questions?
Thank you, Secretary.
Pia Rappler. Microphone. Thank you.
Good morning, sir. Sir, morning. Given these priority bills, do we already have a timeline for when the LEDAC will convene?
No timeline yet. There is no schedule yet. In due time, we will announce the schedule.
Okay. So, sir, just to clarify, death penalty and acts on federalism are part of our priority bills. You're just not mentioned kumbaga comprehensively under
not those. Mentioned by the executive secretary, but we are going into that because we have considered the legislative commitments of the president in Isuna as among the sources of priority bills.
Thank you, Pia. Dreo Calonzo.
Hi, sir. Andrea Calonzo po from Bloomberg. Sir, you mentioned something about adjustments in the sin taxes. What kind of adjustment is this po?
We have yet to await the bill that will come from the Department of Finance. We have included this because the Department of Finance has mentioned to us its priorities also. So among them are the four, but no bill has been submitted to us yet.
Sir, another thing, do you have specifics on which of these bills will be the very first priority? Which ones do you want to be passed first?
We have yet to coordinate with the cabinet in a cluster manner of meeting in order to sound out from the entire cabinet which should be given preference so that we can make the necessary follow-up. We can convey the matter to the Senate and to the House of Representatives. As of now, no word yet from the cabinet as a whole.
Thank you, sir.
Dexter? Microphone, please.
Secretary, good morning.
Morning.
Dito sa binabanggit na priority bills, nabanggit nyo na may dalawang department na lilikhain.
Dalawang
departments na bubuuin. The Department for Housing and Urban Development and the Department for Overseas Filipinos.
Yes, under, is that under the...
The Department of Housing is under the DBM priorities.
That is recommended by DBM, right sizing of the bureaucracy and the creation of this Department of Housing and Urban Development, but no specific bill yet has been forwarded to us on this. We will just give in the notice that this is a priority insofar as the BM is concerned.
Thank you, Dexter. No more questions? Thank you. Ace, last question from Ace.
Secretary, you mentioned you'll meet regularly. How frequent the LEDAC will meet? How frequent and how do you intend to fast track the passage of these priority bills?
First, the regular meeting of the LEADAC, we would propose a regular meeting of once every 2 months. And then how do we fast track the passage of the measures? First, the cabinet has to agree. The cabinet members have to agree among themselves in coordination with PLLO on which bills to post through among the priorities. And then we communicate the matter to the House and to the Senate. And that's the job of PLLO to make the necessary follow-up.
Thank you, Ace. Thank you, Secretary Sitoy. No more questions. Thank you, Secretary Sitoy. Presidential Spokesperson Ernesto Abella.
Good morning. I hear you're rushing, so we'll only keep it to one point. Thank you, Secretary Adelino Sitoy, Presidential Legislative Advisor. Dagang salamat. Okay. Just like to touch on 3 points. Number one, Philippine-China relations at a new turning point. According to the Chinese Vice Foreign Minister Liu Zhenmin, the two countries may be on track to dialogue, consultation, and friendly cooperation. The president, in this connection, the president has also tasked the defense and military establishment to study the options to source military equipment from either China and or Russia, but they're not closing the options to these two alone. Second, regarding the UN statements on the president's understanding of human rights, Ambassador Cecilia Rebong, permanent Philippine representative to the UN in Geneva, gave the Philippine statement on the second day of the 33rd session of the Human Rights Council, which belied the statement of the UN High Commissioner's statement that President Duterte has a shoot-to-kill order for drug suspects. Rebong stated that that Duterte never empowered police officers to shoot to kill any individual whom they suspected of drug crimes. Number three, DSWDI's $1.4 billion to help drug surrenderies. The goal is the reintegration of users back into the community, which is the part of the second phase of the anti-drug campaign. Part of the second phase is the raising up of social workers, trained social workers, and addressing the stay-in rehab clients, which would be approximately 1% of those who have already surrendered. So roughly about 10,000 will be in stay-in facilities. That is all. Thank you. Any questions, please?
First question will come from Raymond Tinasa, Bombo Radio.
Sir, good morning. I understand some questions were already asked by Benji Liwanag earlier, but I, as on my way here, I was monitoring the Senate hearing, and there are this direct account from a witness member of the Lambada Boys, now the Davao Death Squad, wherein he directly accused the president, then Mayor Duterte, of masterminding the killing of criminals and rapists and other heinous crime suspects, and also the massacre or bombing firing of some mosque, especially in Bangkeruhan in Davao City after the bombing of the cathedral on, I think, the 80s or 90s. So can you, sir, at least as an addendum perhaps to the statement of Secretary Andanar earlier, your reaction to now ongoing Senate hearing?
Well, what the whatever testimonies, the whatever statements that the person is saying is his own statement, and you will have to await proper investigation regarding the matter.
Thank also, you. Sir, at least for now, any message to our brother and brothers from the Muslim community, perhaps because they might. In this might inspire them and trigger unnecessary, trouble.
I believe, as in all cases, all citizens should maintain a sense of sobriety and maintain a sense of objectivity. I mean, after all, people do make statements every day. And while this person may sound credible, it is imperative that each and every one of us properly weigh whatever is said and respond at the right time.
And lastly, sir, do you think these latest allegations against the president will, in one way or the other, could affect the Duterte war against drugs and criminalities and the general platform of governance of this Duterte administration?
The platform is the platform is the desire to be to have a peaceful, crime-free, corruption-free nation, and that is not affected. That vision is not changed, and the president continues to be to exercise political will, and I believe we all need to continue rallying around the desire to have a nation that is a nation for everyone, and that there's space for everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Yes. Yes.
Pia, microphone.
Good morning, sir.
Yes,
sir,
Pia.
You said earlier that President Duterte never gave any orders to shoot to kill, but in fact, he's been caught on video giving that exact order. For example, relating to Mayor Espinosa. Of Albuyarleta, he gave an order of shoot on right. site, and yeah. you always see him, diba, giving these statements. So,
yes.
how do you then prove that he never gives these statements?
There is no written order that states that. What is stated is that they can shoot in order to protect themselves.
Sir, but his orders, if they resist arrest, that does not necessarily mean that they are out to kill the officers, diba? I mean.
Right. What?
They will really resist arrest. So,
right.
But that doesn't mean that they pose a danger to the officers.
There are two positions there, right? One is if you see a suspect, you shoot and kill, right? The other one is that, but the written directive really is that you are to defend yourself if they resist arrest.
But sir, even if there are written directives, the fact that he says them verbally and this is broadcast all over the nation, won't some policemen tend to think that since he said it verbally, it's not consistent with whatever written orders there are, and so it might create confusion among the police.
As far as we know, these are the policemen. Those in armed forces are properly instructed before they leave. All right, and if you listen to him to his statements, part of his, like we said earlier, that his messages are layered. And part of these is addressed to criminals. He said he justified his tendency to threaten criminals. So part of the, it may be that part of the messaging is really addressed to criminals.
So are the police instructed not to listen
the police
to
are
his
properly,
verbal?
No, let's put it this way. The police are instructed how to go about properly before they leave.
Follow-up question or other issue? Okay, no more? I think it's okay, Nazar. Okay.
One more.
Vance Fernandez. And then J.P. Soriano. Microphone.
Good morning, sir. Do you have the estimated cost of the foreign trips of the president?
Do I have the what?
Estimated cost, COST, foreign trips of the president.
No.
Until now, sir?
You can ask DBM if you want.
DBM? Mm. But you are the presidential spokesperson, sir. Anyway, sir.
you want me to keep an accounting book with me?
No,
that's
sir.
That's really being just smart aleck.
Sir, until now, sir, yung mga papers ng mga presidential appointees, hindi pa ho nalalagdaan. And then, yung mga salary po nila na pupunta po dun sa mga datihan. Wala po bang magagawa pa until now?
I'm sure they're doing their part in the administrative section. But as far as I know, that their new appointees were sworn in the other day, right? And I'm sure they're now on the way to receiving the benefits of their efforts.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vance. J.P. Soriano. GMA 7.
Good morning. Morning, Secretary.
Yes.
Sir,
yes,
sir. Sir, just to clarify the friendly dialogue between China and the Philippines, that would mean that there will be an official bilateral meetings between the two countries, and were there any conditions set? Did China set any conditions? What are the parameters? We'll bring up, of course, the arbitral tribunal decision. Can you just share also, sir, some of the things that were discussed during FBR when he was part of the meeting yesterday during the cabinet? Can you just also share some of the things that was discussed there?
I'm not sure if when I was there, FBR was not present. However, the conversations between the two countries are initially basically friendly, just a, you could almost say, getting to know you. The whole purpose is to be able to establish warmer relationships. So I'm not aware that there are preconditions to the conversation. However, however, there is an openness now to do so. But I'm not aware of any preconditions to the conversation. Thank you.
Thank you. Last
one last question, please.
Good morning, Secretary.
Yes.
Sir, any reaction po dito kay Senator Lacson? Meron pong sinasabi siya, wasak na imahe ng bansa dahil sa pagkakalat ni Pangulong Duterte sa international community.
All right.
Any reaction, sir?
Well, I think the good senator should check what actually is happening or has happened recently. For example, after the ASEAN, in fact, during the ASEAN, his relationships were pretty warm. He was warmly applauded by our neighbors, and that should matter to us. That should matter a lot. That actually we are solidifying our relationships.
So, sa tingin niyo, sir, hindi nakalat si Pangulong Duterte on
sa tingin ko, I think it's being some of the actions may be magnified out of proportion.
Thank you very much, Secretary.
Thank you very
much.
Thank
you, Presidential Spokesperson Ernesto Abella. Thank you, Malacañang Press Corps, back to our main studio sa Radyo ng Bayan and PTV Channel 4.
Thank you.